next topic in this field is on NMOSD, on neuromyelitis optica spectrum disorder. So point one is, what is Devic's disease or neuromyelitis optica? So this condition was known as neuromyelitis optica previously, and also as Devic's disease. So Eugene Devic is a French neurologist from Lyon in France. So in the year 1894, he described his condition in a patient whom he saw. It was a 45-year-old woman who came to him with bilateral visual impairment, and he found out that the patient had something like optic neuritis. Then 2 months later, the same woman came back to him with something which looked like myelitis. So subsequently, the patient died. So he did the autopsy on this patient and then found out that the pathology in the optic nerves and the spinal cord were somewhat similar, and he thought that the same disease is perhaps affecting those two areas of the CNS. So then he called this neuromyelitis optica. So this is supposed to be the very first, of course, the recorded report of a patient with neuromyelitis optica, a condition which affects the spinal cord and the optic nerves, as the name implies. Devic's student, who was a PhD student doing for his thesis, he went on to write about 16 cases, similar cases existing at that time, same year, 1894. And then he, in his thesis, found out that some of those patients were actually relapsing. Because Devic's patient died after a few months, so he couldn't see whether, he thought it was a monophasic illness. So some of them were relapsing. So Gall, the student, he thought that perhaps they are a variant of multiple sclerosis. So that is the history. Then, of course, over the last 110 years, Devic's disease has evolved a lot. And today we know this condition is a totally different thing from what we knew earlier. And especially after the year 2004, when this in the US, Wanda Lennon and her team made this groundbreaking discovery of this serum autoantibody, which is a marker for neuromyelitis optica, aquaporin 4 antibody, or NMO antibody as it was known then, by Lennon and the other team, which includes Sean Peacock and Kazuo Fujihara and all them. So this was in 2004. So after that, this became a disease entity on its own, totally different from MS. And also this aquaporin 4, the specific marker autoantibody, which binds at the blood-brain barrier. So this distinguishes MS from NMO. So therefore, this earlier condition known as opticospinal MS, which was a variant of, supposed to be a variant of MS found in countries like Japan, Korea, and so on, that seemed to be, it is no longer used, that terminology. Opticospinal MS was discontinued because there's no need for that. Most of them turned out to be NMO. So NMO, or neuromyelitis optica spectrum disorder, this 2004 was a landmark discovery. Then 2005, the antigen was discovered, which was an antigen at the astrocyte food processor near the blood-brain barrier. So the antibody test enabled accurate diagnosis. And importantly, NMO is often misdiagnosed as MS. So important to distinguish this, because the treatment, long-term treatment, is quite different. And treating these patients with MS DMTs can be harmful. And this is a highly specific antibody, but some of them may not have it. About 70 to 80% will have the antibody. Some of the seronegatives had another antibody called MOG-IgG in them. So the target antigen, as I said, was discovered in 2005. It's the most abundant water channel protein in the CNS, highly concentrated in the spinal cord gray matter. And so this primarily targets astrocytes. So sometimes this is known as an astrocytopathy as a result, rather than a demyelinating condition. So NMO IgG or aquaporin 4 IgG so plays a direct role in the pathogenesis. So it's probably a pathogenic antibody. So apart from acetylcholine receptor antibody in myasthenia gravis, which is thought to be the prototype autoimmune disorder with a pathogenic antibody, this is the second condition where they think that the antibody is pathogenic. So therefore, it would be playing a vital role in the causation of the disease. So there are different areas of the brain where these astrocyte food processors have these water channels, and area postrema in the medulla is a preferred target, leading to astrocyte dysfunction in that area, which clinically manifests as area postrema syndrome with intractable nausea, vomiting. Point three is, why is this disease now known as NMOSD? So this was known earlier as NMO. Now it is known as NMOSD. So spectrum disorder, because in 2007, Mayo Clinic, where the antibody was discovered, they introduced this term NMOSD to acknowledge that some patients with aquaporin 4 antibodies have recurrent transverse myelitis without optic neuritis and vice versa. So they were not fulfilling the 2006 criteria, or known as Wingachuk criteria at the time. They were not fulfilling that, because they had either optic neuritis or myelitis recurring with the antibody. So that is why they used the term neuromyelitis optica spectrum disorder. However, from 2015, the diagnostic criteria have changed. So now it is possible to make the diagnosis in the presence of the antibody, whether you have only optic neuritis or myelitis. Still, you could make the diagnosis with one core clinical criteria. Then the prevalence, of course, this is a new disease. So we don't have a lot of data, because actually the antibody was only discovered in 2004. However, the prevalence rate range could be something between 0.5 to 4 per 100,000, up to about 10 in certain racial groups. The range comparatively across the globe is less relative to MS, because in MS there are certain regions of the brain where it's very common and certain regions it's not so. But that variation, geographic variation, is not so evident in them, in patients with NMOSD. However, in certain communities, countries like Japanese, the Oriental countries, Chinese, Koreans, they have a higher prevalence. And also in certain, even in the same country, certain racial groups might have a higher prevalence. Like, for example, the black population in the US have a higher prevalence. And certain parts of the same country also might have a different prevalence. Like, for example, in Japan, the Hokkaido Island is supposed to be having a higher prevalence of the disease. So these are the new how to diagnose NMOSD. Of course, the best way to diagnose is to get the antibody done, and if the antibody is positive. So these are the criteria that are being used currently. The 2015 criteria, which is used to diagnose This is the international panel for neuromyelitis optica spectrum disorder, which came up with this criteria. So here we have six core clinical features: optic neuritis, myelitis, area posterior syndrome, brainstem syndrome, narcolepsy, and the cerebral syndrome. So these six core features are used, and the most common of the three, six, are optic neuritis, myelitis, and area posterior syndrome. So these are used along with antibody positivity. You just need at least one core clinical criteria for those patients. But without also, that is the important point here, even without the antibody, we could now make a diagnosis using these criteria with at least two core clinical characteristics. So this has actually helped us to make this diagnosis of NMOSD even in the absence of acoporin 4 antibody positivity. And also a certain percentage of these patients, as I said before, will have a second antibody called MOG antibody. So, but MOG antibody related disorders are completely different because they have a wider phenotypic spectrum with optic neuritis, ADEM-like presentations, with encephalitis, and myelitis as well, so which is not seen in typical acoporin 4 disease. However, about 25% of patients with MOG disease will satisfy these criteria, NMOSD criteria. So these are the core clinical features again. So that is point number five. There are other associated features, like sometimes some of them can have SIADH, hypothermia, hypotension, because of the regions of the brain where these lesions occur in, obesity, hypothyroidism, and secondary amenorrhea, galactorrhea, and so on. And also they sometimes have what is known as episodic tonic spasms in the lower limbs, which are very characteristic. So their sleep is troubled as a result of this. But good thing is they respond very well to carbamazepine. So some of these patients will complain about that as well. So there are, point six is, what are the different distinct NMOSD subgroups? So now we have a group where they have the antibody for the acoporin 4 IgG. So that is one group. They are seropositive for that. Then there's another group of NMOSD where MOG antibody is positive. So there's a third group where both these antibodies are not present. So there are three subgroups. So that is important to remember, because with the current criteria, we could make a diagnosis of NMOSD without either of these antibodies. Anyway, the MOG antibody doesn't come into the current NMO criteria, but it is being worked out. Very soon we'll have a separate set of criteria for MOG as well. But for NMOSD, there are three clinical subgroups. So what is MOG associated disorder? So this is, as I said, myelin oligodendrocyte glycoprotein is a component of CNS myelin. It's a tiny portion, only about 0.5%, but it is highly immunogenic. So that's why it's an important thing. And also it's exclusively expressed in the CNS. So it accounts for less than 0.5%, but highly immunogenic. And it has a potential for a pathogenic role. So serum titers depend on the disease activity and the treatment status. So these two antibodies do not coexist in the same patient, interestingly. And so as I said, there's a wider clinical spectrum of MOG disease. So these are the MOG phenotypes. isolated optic neuritis, isolated recurrent transesmalitis, NMOSD phenotype, which is seen in about 25% to 30%, and the ADEM-like picture, especially in children, where you get an encephalitic picture, and sometimes this keeps it's multiphasic. So in multiphasic ADEM, now known as MDEM, MOG antibodies are supposed to be positive in a large proportion of cases. And another important point is, if you get the MOG antibody positivity in a person who's been investigated or evaluated for CNS-IDD or CNS demyelinating disorder, if the MOG IgG is positive, it's unlikely that the patient has adult onset MS. So that's an important point. It's kind of a reverse biomarker kind of thing in adult patients, because it is said that you cannot have IgG, MOG IgG, if you have MS, adult onset MS. And also the presence of MOG IgG predicts relapsing disease. So as opposed to MS and also NMOSD, this condition occurs in children as well, commonly, children and adults and younger people. And there's female-male ratio is not so striking, like in MS, it's more common in females. NMOSD, aquaporin 4 is 90% in females. But here it's similar, male-female ratio. So the other features are there. Oligoclonal bands are usually negative, and they are again a relapsing disease. And coexistence of other autoimmune diseases is also less common in them, as opposed to aquaporin 4. So aquaporin 4 people may have SLE or myasthenia or ITP or whatever, but here they are less common to have other autoimmune conditions. And there is a worldwide distribution of these diseases, but of course we are at very early stages. We may not have a lot of epidemiological data on these conditions yet. Point 8, what are the MRI characteristics of NMOSD spine? Now, we all know about this long lesion myelitis or long segment myelitis. We talk about it where there is more than three spinal segments, extension of more than three spinal segments, usually central cord involvement in these patients. So these are generally seen in patients with aquaporin 4 disease, long segment myelopathy. A short segment, as I said earlier, is usually seen in the other conditions like MS. But sometimes in aquaporin 4 positive cases, you may not see the long segment myelopathy. You might see a short segment. In about 15% of these patients, you might see the see a short segment myelopathy. So that has to be kept in mind when you are looking at the spine. What about brain lesions in them? So can they have brain lesions? So this is where the real confusion starts to occur, because you get a lot of brain lesions in some of these patients. So with the clinical presentation being somewhat similar to MS, may have optic neuritis, myelitis, and brain lesions make it confusing for one to diagnose, sometimes to diagnose NMOSD. So it is not uncommon for patients being diagnosed as MS when they have either MOG disease or aquaporin 4 disease. So the brain lesions, there are some typical brain lesions which are given in this slide: periependymal surface of the corpus callosum, hypothalamus, periaqueductal area, area postrema, and so on. So different parts of the brain where these food processes have these water channels where these antibodies bind to and give rise to these brain lesions. This again shows the brain lesions in different parts of the brain where these things which occurs in aquaporin 4 disease. Then this area postrema syndrome we talk about a lot. This is important because sometimes these patients present with intractable nausea, vomiting, and hiccups going on for many weeks, and they do a lot of investigations, upper GI endoscopies, barium swallows, and so on, and find nothing. And I have had a few patients who have been referred to psychiatrists. ECTs have been done on them, thinking that this is psychogenic vomiting and psychogenic problems. And the moment you give methylprednisolone infusions, the methylprednisolone IV, they get better completely. So it's important not to miss this. Then about the optic nerves, in aquaporin 4 disease, optic nerves are involved, and involvement is usually posterior, and it can also involve the chiasm as well. It can be bilateral. So there can be gadolinium enhancing lesions, bilateral, posterior part of the optic nerve, and the chiasm. So which is a little different from what we see with MS. You may not see the posterior most part and the chiasm getting involved in MS. And MOG associated optic neuritis, you might see the perineural enhancement as a result of the soft tissue around the nerve getting involved in the problem as well. So there may be enhancement around the nerve, the perineural tissues, soft tissues, giving rise to that appearance, which is only seen in MOG disease usually. So, and MOG can involve both sides. It can involve both eyes, the bilateral. It can be more commonly bilateral as opposed to aquaporin 4 MS. So, well, this has just this is a very busy slide, just showing some key imaging features which differentiates MS from NMO. So in optic neuritis, long segment myelitis, corpus callosal lesions, periventricular lesions, infratentorial lesions, corticospinal tracts, and the central venule. So just to briefly list some of the differences in imaging, MS versus NMOSD, which is important sometimes because the clinical presentation is somewhat quite similar. So you might have difficulty in separating it out. And the long-term treatment is the most important thing, which needs this differentiation is very important, especially because it's not easy to get the serology done always. We are fortunate to have this ongoing collaboration with Mayo Clinic. We have been having this going for the last 8 years or so now. Since we have that collaboration, we can do the proper testing method of with cell-based assays of both the aquaporin 4 and MOG antibody. But it's not freely available. So initially, it might be quite difficult to separate this out. So all these MRI changes might be useful. Yeah, so this point 9, this slide is about aquaporin 4 associated NMOSD. How do you differentiate it from MOG disease? So as I said, MOG disease patients more likely to have bilateral optic neuritis. So they are more likely to have optic nerves involved there and the spinal cord. So you get the large, even in our cohort, the large percentage of patients with MOG disease have only got optic neuritis. They don't have myelitis to that extent. So they can have the simultaneous bilateral optic neuritis is also more commonly seen in MOG disease. More likely to be monophasic and fewer relapses as opposed to aquaporin 4. So less likely to be associated with autoimmune disorders, as I said earlier. Proportionately, more brainstem cerebellar lesions supratentorial lesions are less. Spinal cord lesions might occur lower down in the lumbar region also, thoracolumbar region, whereas NMO lesions are mostly in the cervicodorsal region. So it could be lower down. And of course, they can have, as I said, encephalitis, encephalomyelitis, ADEM-like picture with a similar male to female ratio. Yeah, this slide again is to differentiate the two clinical features, the aquaporin 4 with mock guiding. So the third group, as I said, is NMOSD without both these antibodies. So still you could make this diagnosis. We are not very sure what exactly is going on with this group. However, they have the similar clinical picture, investigation findings, everything fits in, other than the fact that they don't have either of the antibodies in them. So the final point is on how to treat these patients. So acute treatment, as I said, is very similar because we do the same things in most of these CNS demyelinating disorders, multiple sclerosis, recurrent optic neuritis, myelitis, ADEM, MDEM, and cryon and NMOSD. All these conditions, we use the same kind of treatment for acute relapses or acute presentations. So it is IV methylprednisolone, PLEX, plasma exchange, immunoglobulins. So it's the same thing in most of them. However, the long-term treatment is quite different. So in this, this is a disease which is a little bit different from MS as we know now, because it is relapse-based actually. Because relapse prevention is the most important thing in NMOSD, because with each relapse, you can get actually the damage is due to the relapse rather than progression of the disease in between relapses. There are a few reports of that happening in some parts of the world, but mostly it is the relapse. So if you stop the relapse occurring, you could say that you have stopped the disease also, whereas in MS, it might be that even between relapses, still the disease could progress. So that's an important point. So you have to, you do everything possible to stop the relapses. So in order to do so, we use various drugs, steroids orally, azathioprine, MMF, rituximab is being used now very effectively. So these drugs are available to us to use. So, so commonly we use steroids with azathioprine, rituximab, MMF, and so on for long-term management. However, with the latest developments from 2019, many drugs have been now FDA approved to be used as medications to prevent relapses in NMOSD. So eculizumab is the drug which reduces relapses by 94% according to the studies done. So it was FDA approved, fast-tracked and approved in 2019 because of the effectivity of the drug. So basically, if you are achieving 94% relapse reduction, as I said, it's a relapse-based disease. So you could be looking at a cure almost. So then there are other drugs, trastuzumab, tocilizumab, and so on. So these are newer drugs which are used to prevent relapses. So there is a again a table showing these drugs, the newer drugs. We don't, in Sri Lanka at the moment, we don't have these drugs. They are new anyway, FDA approved only in 2019. Right, so I think that brings us to the end of the 10 points. So this was just another overview of neuromyelitis optica spectrum disorder, how it has evolved from 1894 to today. So after 110 years, in 2004, the disease was completely changed the way we look at this condition. And also, if not identified early and treated, this is a more devastating condition than MS, because patients go blind and they become paralyzed. So early diagnosis is a very, very important in this condition. So fortunately, I think in our cohort in the National Hospital, we have been able to manage most of them successfully with early treatment and early initiation of plasma exchange, acute treatment, relapses being treated, and also long-term management. We have been able to do so. But this is a condition which can be really disabling if undetected, goes undetected and untreated. In fact, so much so, initially when we started this collaboration with Mayo Clinic, they were telling us to go to blind school and get samples from them as well. To see this, there are maybe so many unexplained blind people as a result of this.